Hello?
Hello?
Is that Dean's mum?
No, I think you might have the wrong number.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Hey, Ben.
I just called the wrong number and some woman picked up.
I was going to say, wait, you must have got the wrong number. No, I don't. There's no bird here.
I thought you were playing a prank. I was like, is that Dean's mum? I said, and she's like, no. I thought he's got to be pulling my leg. He's got to be... He's up to something.
Is it someone else?
I think it was one of my customers, actually.
All right.
Yeah. What's going on?
No, it's not me. Oh, man. I didn't realise how much social media gave a shit about Big Mike's wang.
Oh, I haven't seen this. What's happened?
I thought it was just a little giggle. You know, Michelle Obama's probably a man.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I was having some fun with it on social media and posting examples of the traps and the penis and stuff like that. And I haven't got insane. I've lost about, I've lost about 15 Facebook friends in about, I don't know, a couple of hours. A few hours. When you look at the stuff I talk about sometimes, that's why I find it particularly fascinating. It's sort of something and nothing, you know? But,
of course, you can say whatever you want about Trump, you know, you can.
Yeah, right? And I think, like, I could sit here all day, and I think, I swear 30% of the population do this, could sit here all day and post, like, anti-Trump memes and laugh at his orange face and his stupid hair that's probably a wig and all that.
Yeah, you can make fun of the way he looks, you can say spiteful stuff, you can say cruel, horrible, you can say whatever you want as long as it's about...
I can make death threats. I could make an effigy of his bleeding head and film myself holding it.
Yeah.
And I'll probably get a TV show, at least an advert or something.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. But, you could have an inflatable big orange Trump and fly it over the city and no one would care. With it, what is it with him dressed as a baby, isn't it? It's like a baby...
It's in a nappy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think. Ironically, they were trying to show how immature Trump is by taking a big fucking balloon of him and flying it over London during his visit.
But if you say anything about anybody on the left, you're terrible.
The jaws come out. I thought this for ages, and I've talked about it with friends and stuff, and we had a laugh about it and what have you. It's the first time I sort of full on about it.
Yeah,
on Facebook.
The selective outrage is funny, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Are you fucking serious with this shit?
Yeah.
Has it happened? No. You know, it's not a serious issue whether or not Big Mike's got a wang.
When you say you lost friends, did you just see the friend count go down, or did people expressly tell you they were unfriending you?
Two expressly told me I'm out of here, but after that I just I saw the friend count go down, and I got a few of those fucking idiot, is this shit serious comments, and they had loads of likes, and I looked at who'd liked it and it was people that I used to be friends with probably 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, that's the weird thing though, what's the definition of a friend really?
It's not they're not friends. Obviously, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
A friend wouldn't fall out with me over speculating. Period. But especially, and this is what someone said. You know, politicians. That's part of the job. People in political life and stuff. They're there to be critiqued and examined and criticised. And if you don't like it, don't get into politics or don't marry the president.
Yeah, people are willing to be perfectly vulgar and use any kind of language they want when it suits them, and then the next moment they pretend to be offended and sensitive to if you're making fun of somebody who's on their team. I can't really take that seriously.
It's totally selective. It's man. It's not the double standards, it's zero standards. It's just total selective outrage. It's crazy.
Yeah. If they're consistent, you wouldn't mind, would you? No.
Yeah. You could you'd know where they're coming from and you could have a discussion. It's, it's like Trump said in private, recorded in private, while he was bantering about over a decade ago. You know, when you're somebody, when you're Donald Trump, you get to grab him by the pussy. Right? He said that, and that was a big news story for about 2 years. Then you've got Joe Biden, not just grabbing pussy, but grabbing children.
Mm.
And groping them and sniffing the hair and running his hands all over them. And, but you're not allowed to say that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's crazy. It's great. I feel like it's intensifying.
Is it? I'm not sure. Like, from my perspective...
I hope it isn't. You know, like I said, that's just it's a feeling, and I hope it's just because I'm a bit wacky. But
you could be right. I'm not sure. I don't think I'm so focused on it. I don't think I spend as much time on it as you do. I think I don't think so. So I'm not sure.
I know you've got more of a life than me. I'm aware you do things outside of this and what have you. This is. Majority of my focus.
That's the trouble, isn't it? Because we've got the same nature in many ways. You know, I am interested in it, and I do follow it, and I do post stuff, and we got the same point of views. But I try and keep it in balance with everything else as best I can. You know, I don't always succeed, but I try and I limit my focus.
You're good at that. That's something I've noticed about you. You divide your time pretty well, like to the different areas.
Yeah,
one of my downfalls is all the eggs in one basket.
And it's one of those things. It's not that it's right or wrong, or you should or you shouldn't. But the question is, like, does it work? You know, is it working overall? Like, that's I'm not pointing the finger at you either, but that's what I ask myself. You know, is my life working? Am I happy? Is it in balance? You know, that's what really matters, I think.
Yeah. And I suppose only you can really answer that, can't you? There's no, there's no template for the perfect life, that applies to everybody.
Yeah, that's one of the good distinctions. I've told you before, I'm in this group, this property group, right? But the coach, even though it is property, she's basically a life coach, and we end up just talking about all areas of life. So it's really a life coaching group, really. And cool. That's one of the distinctions she makes. She doesn't really refer to stuff in terms of right and wrong or shouldn't. She always makes us think of it in terms of does it work or not, you know?
Yeah, that's good. Do you ever see the film Whatever Works, starring Larry David? I'm not sure if he wrote it or not.
No, I haven't.
That's well good. I'm not saying that. I've seen very few films in my life. I could probably count on one finger how many films I've seen. Yeah, it's particularly good. And that's basically the gist of it. You know, life's rough. Things aren't what you expect. Things aren't going according to plan. I'm not doing a good sell. But he settles into a pattern that, just works and finds himself happy.
How old's the film? Anyway.
Must be about 10 years or so. I think I saw it about 6 or 7 years ago. I think it was before Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Is Larry David in it?
Yeah. Yeah, he's the star, the main guy.
Oh, okay. Oh, I like him.
Main character. Yeah, he's funny, isn't he?
Yeah. I love him. I'm surprised I haven't seen that. I wasn't aware of that.
He's the best Jew.
Is he sort of playing himself, like the usual character?
Pretty much, yeah. He's less... You know, because on Curb Your Enthusiasm, he's quite on-the-nose funny. You know, he's quite blatantly comedic. Whereas in this one, he's just more—he's more of a stressed old guy. It's not as comedy, if you will, but
stressed good, good old stuff. Guy. Yeah, I do like that character. I think he's great. I think he's great.
Yeah.
There's something ironic about like the pettiness of him, like knowing that he's so successful and so rich because he made so much money from Seinfeld.
I think he's like 100 million. I just pull out my ass.
It was hundreds. No, hundreds. I think it was closer to a billion, I think.
Oh.
Yeah. He's crazy
rich. Super rich.
And that, what do you call it? Juxtaposition or the irony of the fact he's so petty and he gets in all these day-to-day little squabbles and scrapes. Yeah. And he's so... Like, if he was just, like, a broke person, it, might not be so funny. Do you know what I mean?
That's a good point, yeah. It's because you'd think if I was in his position, I'd have to... Whatever the foresight or whatever it is, overlook little insignificant. That guy owes me 5 cents, or whatever the hell it is.
Yeah,
but he's got a very that particular idea of how things have to be and things have to be right, and it's funny.
Yeah, it's so out of proportion in the context of his success, yeah. You know, the stuff that that grinds his gears.
Yeah. You know, that ice cream keeps dripping, you keep having to lick it.
Yeah, I like it. What else have you been up to then?
I don't know, I've nothing new to report, Ben. Just I'm on the same treadmill, just doing the same the same guy doing the same things. No breakthroughs. I don't know. I fancy to chat, really. I fancy getting a few things off my chest and seeing what's still bouncing around inside my head.
What, just Michelle Obama's dick or other stuff?
No, that's it. I saw that. Just God, thank God that's not bouncing around inside my head. I saw that thing you said today. It's safe to express left-leaning points of view.
Yeah.
You know, because conservatives aren't violent. And it's unsafe to express conservative points of view because liberals are violent.
Mm.
Like, yeah, man. That's so very true. And how inverted is that, you know, compared to the template that I think we're all raised with? I don't want to say all, but certainly me growing up, it was like right wing is synonymous with evil, basically. Synonymous with racist, synonymous with bigot, you know, all those words.
Mm.
Increasingly over time. And when you test this stuff out for yourself and talk to people, and that is, man, the opposite is striking.
Yeah.
I've said this before, but how you can actually, with right-leaning people and conservatives or whatever you want to call them, you can actually discuss stuff. Like, you'll give me the freedom to disagree and say, nah, I don't think so. And, you know, we can just back and forth and find a middle ground. But on team liberal or team left, whatever you want to call it, it's so culty.
Yeah.
It's, yeah. I don't know.
I've gotten
turned off from it to, like, I'm a bit afraid of it. Because I think it's the masses as well. It's the majority, especially around my sort of age group. Maybe it's just because I'm in arts and what have you.
Yeah. Yeah, I can relate. You know, I mean, I might have done a better job of extracting myself from it and planting myself away from it. I don't think you've extracted yourself from it by the sound of it, have you?
No. Well, what I've sort of done is I've just sort of extracted myself. And then, another way of saying it is isolated myself.
Mm.
And that's no long-term plan.
No, that's sort of half the solution, isn't it? Got rid of the problem, but you haven't replaced it with something positive to fill its place.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You need to carry on that project and get some, like, more like-minded people around you.
No, absolutely. Oh, yeah. It's not over. Getting going.
I don't know if you saw the second part. I added a bit more to that post, actually, because, like, knowing that people would disagree. Like, there's a simple experiment. You can go and put a sign in your front window saying vote Tory or leave Europe or better, you know, better without Europe or whatever it is, or put it in your car, put a bumper sticker on, you know, so any right-leaning conservative kind of thing. And you can just test it. You know, anybody that disagrees, just do that, see what happens. And, it, you know, if you think peaceful liberals are nothing to worry about, then there's nothing to fear, is there?
What do you mean? Just wait for the swarm of pussy hats to surround your car with pitchforks?
Yeah. I mean, in Bristol, there's Bristol's just a liberal hellhole, and there's a lot of graffiti and street art, and there's one thing saying, like, immigrate, or I don't know, some pro-immigration thing. It says immigrant. I can't remember what it says exactly on across the side of a building. And I there's loads of stuff like that. There's like there's a community building, and it's they put big signs saying "out with the Tories" or something like that. And I think you can only say
stuff, Lancaster.
Right.
All over.
I mean, if you put the opposite and put the opposite thing, they'd burn the building to the ground.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, maybe I should start doing it. Maybe I should sneak out in the night with little... Because I see, for some reason, the new thing with quote-unquote graffiti in Lancaster seems to be people writing on sticky labels and then they're sticking that on bridges and stuff, which, in some ways, that's nicer, I guess. It's a bit less permanent, you know? A bit less destructive.
Right.
But maybe I should sneak out in the night with some Jeremy Corbyn is a pussy stickers. Or whatever. I want Trump to grab my pussy. just to counteract the balance a little bit. We got them outside the bus station. Someone had got, what was it? Like these Brexit stickers, like circle Brexit stickers. And they'd put loads of them on the electric box, whatever it is, the generator. I don't even know what you call something outside the bus station, anyway. And they'd written no, the big letter N and the big O, with a made out of all these Brexit stickers. And that had been there for a long time. And this is like one of the busiest parts at the bus, major bus station in Lancaster. And just last week, while I was sat there waiting, I scratched them all off with a 50p, and it took me about 30 seconds. And, you know, people driving back, I was getting looks and stuff, but no one actually said anything.
I have been tempted to do like a video project, like put on a MAGA hat and like get someone to film it or have a camera on me or something like that, and just walk around and just see what reactions you get, just as an experiment, and then maybe do the same with a, like a, whatever, I don't know, Bernie or Corbyn or Labour or hat, and just do it as like a social experiment, just to video the difference in the way people respond.
That's good. I think, yeah, man. You should do that. I'd like to do that if you don't mind me stealing your idea.
go for it, because awesome. I don't think I'm going to do it. But you know, it'd be a good.
It would be self-telling. I can see it already.
Yeah. I mean, there's quite a few Americans that are doing that kind of thing, isn't there? Going on college campuses and like asking liberals questions. But I don't really see, apart from Paul Joseph Watson, nobody's really doing that here, are they? I don't think.
None I can bring to mind, no. I was going to say that Caitlin Bennett, but she's American, isn't she?
Yeah.
You've seen her, right?
Yeah, yeah, the pro-gun chick.
Yeah, she's ace.
Do you see the one where she goes up to the girl and she's like, and the girl's like, "We're not talking to you because you're a racist." And she's like, "Oh really? How am I a racist? What have I said?" And the girl's like, "Everyone knows you are." And she's like, "Okay, great. So what did I say that was racist? Listen, you know you're a racist. We all know you're racist." It's just like going round in circles. Did you see that?
I'm not sure if I've seen that particular one. I've seen a few of them with so I guess a British lad talking about guns, and it's got that whole like jaw dropped, wide eyed look on his face throughout the whole thing. Like, can't even right now. I'm not sure I've seen the race one.
I'm loving the Hodge twins as well.
Yeah, they're quality, aren't they?
Yeah.
Saw that thing the other day, and I'm talking about what it's like being a Trump supporter in comedy. Man, yeah, that must be tough in America.
Well, I haven't seen that.
You see what's happened? Oh, you're not?
No.
I thought it was you who shared it.
Oh, I don't think I watched it properly. What'd they say?
They were just talking about how what it's like being a Trump supporter in the comedy world, and you know, what the crowd used to be like compared to how it is now, and how people have got more hostile with them. You know, not just crowds and stuff, but fellow comedians, quote, comedians.
Yeah.
Jokers. You see that Jim Jeffries thing?
No, what's that?
Oh, it was amazing. He got this guy called Avi Yemeni, who's on YouTube, quite a good channel. He invited him to his show on Comedy Central to try and frame him as an alt-right, et cetera, et cetera. Muslim, Islamophobe, that was the big one. That was the main angle. And Avi Yemeni, geniusly, thankfully, he thought to put his phone down before the interview started, you know, and film the whole thing, so that once they chopped it up and edited it to all shit and back, and made him out to be the desired villain, he could go on YouTube and say, "Check out the real interview." And it's completely, not only the opposite of what they showed, but Jim Jeffries on camera, on TV, he's like playing Oprah. "Sadly, these days, Islamophobia," you know, and all that. But when you watch the full interview, he draws Muhammad. He's saying that he hates Islam. He's saying burqas are stupid. He's doing and saying all of the stuff he's accusing the other guy of. And he literally says, "Oh, I never look bad in my segments. We'll edit all this out."
Really?
Yeah. Yes.
I'm confused. The interviewer is expressing anti, sort of, or he's making fun of Islam. Is that what you mean?
The interviewer, Jim Jeffries, during the actual interview, the legitimate interview, he's saying all kinds of shit about Islam. He draws Muhammad, you know, the sin that he's drawing Muhammad.
Right.
And even the guy he's interviewing, who he's trying to frame, he's like, oh, come on, man, don't do that. I've got enough death threats on me already. And Jim's like, we'll edit it out and all that.
I see.
And now he's being pretty reasonable in the interview. He doesn't agree with mass immigration. He's not a fan of Islam. But the way they chop up his answers to different questions, they paint him out to be a total racist, and they paint out Jim Jeffries to be Mother Teresa.
So was he being that way to kind of like egg the other guy on, to getting him to loosen up and sort of express certain points of view, to, you know, deliberately to sort of frame him?
I think Jim Jeffries is obviously I'm assuming, but I don't think he's pro or anti-Islam. I don't think he has any standards. I think he's a funny drunk who likes fame and likes being as in the centre of LA as he can possibly get. And so if Comedy Central say, hey, will you frame this guy and let it out, and whatever you said looks, but yeah, whatever. Yeah, I think like most people, he's probably got concerns about mass immigration of incompatible cultures. But obviously, he can't say or joke about them and still have a show on Comedy Central.
It's so easy to kind of corner people. I can't remember who I was chatting to online, and I can't remember what the conversation was about. They made some comment that was kind of critical and mocking white people, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
And I can't remember how the conversation went. I think they said something that was sort of complimentary and positive about black or ethnic races. And I said, as you might expect, that's very interesting. You're sort of willing to compliment one, you know, criticize one and compliment the other. So just out of interest, is there anything you think the white race is sort of particularly good at or deserves praise for, and is there anything you think, you know, other races deserve criticism for, or they've done anything badly? And as you can expect,
was it a white woman?
Yeah, of course.
Right. Yeah. Did she log out at this point?
Well, when I asked her if she was, you know, willing to do the, of course she wouldn't, and she was like, well, I believe all people are the same and I don't really believe in race, you know, so she'll only praise and criticize in one direction. She won't praise or criticise in the other direction. So, you know how it goes. But it's kind of fun sort of cornering people a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. That's a big thing, you know, that like white and whiteness is sort of synonymous with lame. Not even necessarily racist or hateful, but, you know, just like lame and like, I'm going to say fag, but you can't say that in any context, but you know what I mean? Just, like, oh, that's so white.
Mm.
I got a friend who's, I'm not going to mention his name because I love him. I don't want to cause any problems. But he works in schools and, you know, with kids and in arts and stuff. And he says that's quite a thing that he hears quite often. Like, if someone, you know, writes a shit song or whatever, they go, oh, that's so white. He's like, hang on a minute. You know, the Beatles were white. Like,
yeah.
Lots of, if not the majority, of great singer-songwriters throughout time have been white. You know, there's at the very least nothing wrong with being white.
Yeah, yeah.
It's sort of become conflict, you know, that white is,
I had somebody on my podcast, and she was a psychology woman, and we were talking about psychological traits. She'd studied psychology, and she was talking about psychological traits in business and leadership and you know, that kind of thing. And I asked her, what's your opinion about the psychological traits of Donald Trump?
Interesting.
She got very uncomfortable. Yeah. And all she would talk about is, well, yes, it's very interesting to study the ways he manipulates people and deceives people. And I let her talk for a little bit. You know, she was going, you know, all these terrible traits, all these negative traits. And yes, we can learn from that. And I said, so the only thing there is to learn from Donald Trump is sort of to learn about manipulation techniques. There's nothing positive about you can say about his leadership skills or anything like that. And she kind of she was very flustered and didn't know how to answer. It's funny.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's kind of so amazing how it's like it's not been declared officially on the news. This just in, new law passed. No one is allowed to find any good qualities in Donald Trump or face penalty of your head cut off. It's like an unwritten mist in the air that's just like, even though he's clearly a good leader, even though he's clearly a good salesman, even though he's clearly got an incredible self-esteem, like to be able to, like, call it ego, you can paint it in a negative light, or I'm not saying you, but paint it negatively all you want. But for anyone to take that level of not even criticism, but literal hatred from, like, all of the mainstream media outlets, you know, all over the world, and lies, the whole Russia thing, and that, and to take that day in, day out, and still, like, he's not even flinched, seemingly.
Yeah. It's incredible.
It's incredible. It's such an inspiring thing. And the fact that, you know, a psychologist who's aware of bullying and social pressure and can't see that, and I'm sure they can. But what can't admit, you know, that's a quality, that's a strength, that's something she probably admires in him.
Yeah, they probably just call that like narcissistic disorder or something like that. They'll have some way of explaining it so that it's negative.
There's always another side of the coin. There's always a negative way of putting it if it's someone you don't like, you know, if it's someone you do like. There's always this. Politics.
What was the other thing? The other thing I asked her was, I said, what's your point of view on the differences between masculine and feminine traits within the corporate world? And she kind of, she was a bit flustered. She sort of babbled a bit, rambled a bit, didn't say anything in particular. And I said, so are men generally better at leadership in high positions, or is that a myth? And she didn't like that either. She was just like, you know, and she's flustered, and she's like, well, to be honest, I don't think it's about gender. I think sort of, you know, it's best not to see, you know, isn't it weird how averse people are just to fucking answering the question, you know?
Yeah. It's like, I don't know. To give a straight answer assumes an opinion, and to have an opinion will put you in a box in the eyes of other people, and you're either on Team Virtue or Team Trump.
There's something really...
And it's not like that. I mean, we know it's not like that, but it's just, I don't know. I almost feel, you know, sometimes it's as though everyone has been conditioned to believe everyone else is super ignorant, and so they have to tread on eggshells because people might think I'm this, people might think I'm stupid, people might think I'm racist. And deep down, people know, and, you know, when they look themselves in the mirror, in the heart of hearts, they know there's more to this whole political spectrum than the crap in the media, the race baiting and the... Which, you know, I think people know that on an individual level, but we assume stupidity in others, and that will limit, you know, what we say in case they take it the wrong way. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. I was thinking there's something quite powerful about putting a label on something, like Trump hysteria is a label, and it kind of it encapsulates, you know, somebody.
Right, and Trump derangement syndrome. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah, and then
that's my favorite.
Candace Owens said a good one. What was it she said? The grievance Olympics. That was it.
That's a good one. Yeah.
And
when
you put labels on things and kind of mock them and sort of it kind of diffuses the power of, like, when you name it, it removes the, I don't know, it's like it trips it up, it pulls the rug out from under it, doesn't it? When you name the game and the manipulation that's being played, it diffuses it.
Yes, because it's manipulation. Therefore, it relies on deception. It relies on you not seeing it.
Yeah.
You know, it's this thing that goes on in the air and around you and in your orifice. And the moment you can measure it, weigh it, look at it, photograph it, it's exposed. You know, stick a label on it, and it's like, damn, that thing's not effective anymore.
And
one of my favorites was, I can't remember who first came up with it. Have you any ideas? I remember when I first heard it, and I was like, yes! That's that thing that pisses me off. I didn't know what to call And that thing's virtue signaling.
Yeah.
It's a normal one at this point, but I was just like, that was such a... I felt a weight off my shoulders when I first heard someone say that. I was like, yes, boys, we got him.
So, and like, you know, this is something Trump's so good at as well, because the way he gives his opponents nicknames, you know, like Crooked Hillary and Lion Ted and I can't remember who else, but by pinning the label.
What, Jeb, low energy Jeb,
yeah. And he's very good. I mean, he's very good at that. He's very good at identifying somebody's weakness and drawing attention to it, isn't he?
Excellent. Yeah, excellent. Like, it's seemingly sort of done with, like, I think he's a locksmith on the left arm. You know, seemingly done with sort of such sort of flippant bombast, so it's sort of the first thing that came into his head, Crooked Hillary. But I wouldn't be surprised if he sat and stewed on that for a bit, you know, and thought, right, what's phonetically nice sounding? What are the right syllables? What's the, you know, how do I hammer this one home?
Yeah.
You know, for the sake of, don't forget, he was in a presidential campaign. It's like high level tactics and manipulation and word games.
Yeah.
And it's bloody genius what he did with it was the Zodiac Killer. Was that another?
What was that?
Oh, that's what he called one of them. Oh, I can picture his face, but I can't remember his name.
I don't know who that is. Was that one of the opposition candidates?
Yeah, yeah. Do you ever see that meme where there's a guy looking uncomfortable and it says, this human costume is itchy? It's like Ted Cruz!
Oh, right.
I don't know what that means, even, the Zodiac Killer, but I'm pretty sure that was, you know, Ted Cruz.
So I guess what we need is enough clever... That's the thing, like what you said, because it's manipulation, because it's not true, and when you shine a light on it, you know, it vanishes in a way. And, like...
What's that?
When you shine a light on a lie, it vanishes.
Mm.
So
yeah, it loses its power. Yeah,
it's like untruths must take a lot of energy. It must. That's why untruths are so complicated, because they need layers and layers of explanation to constantly obfuscate the simple truth. And
yeah,
I suppose truth must win out because it's so much more efficient to be correct.
Yeah, man. Obviously, I'm just going to say I'm very skeptical of what appears to be high intelligence sometimes. Partly because I'm not that intelligent myself, and a lot of it goes over my head, which I think is natural. But, you know, also when they seem to be squirming with lies, and you know, when the thing to begin with is true, you can sort of go on and flounder and have fun. But when the thing to begin with is a lie, you see him sort of fleshing all this stuff on top of it and making it more and more complicated as it goes on.
Yeah.
And it always turns out that the reason you don't quite fathom it is because you're not as smart as the person saying it. You know?
Yeah, when actually is because what they're saying really doesn't make sense.
Bullshit. Yeah,
that's what I know.
Absolutely. I mean, not to single the guy out or whatever, but it's just like, what's his name? Neil deGrasse Tyson, you guys like that, you science guys, you scientism fellas.
Yeah.
The gravity believers without the evidence will purpose. It's like one of the first go-to things is, well, you know, first of all, you need to understand that, you know, you're one grain of sand in a beach galaxy of Earths. Uncomprehensible, and make you feel small and insignificant, and couldn't possibly grasp the magnitude of my genius. It's like, all right, doctor, tell me what you're telling me. Show me the evidence.
Yeah.
Don't seduce me with insignificance.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't need to be buttered up with adjectives and stuff. You can just explain to me how the fuck it works.
Yeah, I get the world's complicated. I get there's depth, you know. I get things like, you know, just... You're going to give me the evidence.
Yeah, it's an insult to your intelligence, isn't it, to be patronised with grandiose sort of explanations when all you really need is the facts.
Hmm. Yeah, man.
Hey, you're not rolling around that flat earth, are you, Dean?
Hey, I'm stationary on it right now, Ben. As the earth itself seems to be. I don't detect any motion. My hair's the same shape it was when I woke up. The sun's in the same place. I know it's not. The sun's moved across the sky.
You've been doing too much of that Googling, haven't you?
Look at that. Been having a look at it. I don't get it, Ben. I just don't. And not only do I not get it, I don't see anyone who can confidently verify it. For example, how water conforms to the exterior of an object. Like, in my life, water has always taken, it takes the shape of the container you pour it into. It never sticks to the outside of it. And you say, well, how? That's because the thing's not big enough to have a gravitational, you never comprehend. All right, so how big does it have to be for the gravity to take effect where water will stick to it? Earth size, is it?
Hang on,
convenient, isn't it? Is there anything else? Is there something else on the earth? I could see that. How about a smaller gravitational pull, like a tennis ball, and just a little bit of water? Will that all, stick, or will it all roll off?
Hang on, you've lost me a bit. Cause...
I think I hung up with my face.
No, it was me. I ran out of Skype credit. No worries. So I've heard a little bit. I've watched a few of the Flat Earth documentaries and stuff. I've heard, some of the explanations. What I don't understand, what's wrong with the conventional explanation of gravity? Why is that not accepted?
My understanding of what's wrong with the conventional explanation of gravity is, who's to say it exists? Because you can explain all of the phenomena that goes on that supposedly gravity accounts for without any need for that word. Just with simple density. Like if a thing is denser than its environment, its immediate environment, it will be heavier than it, and therefore it sinks. And if it's lighter than its immediate environment, like if you pull a balloon to the bottom of a pool, if it's lighter, then it will, or a helium balloon, for example, is lighter than the oxygen around it, then it will rise.
I don't understand how that disproves
and
that ordinary...
I don't understand where gravity comes in, because other than a word to describe like a magical force that nobody can measure or weigh or see or quantify or photograph, just seems to be a word to describe a magical force that otherwise doesn't seem to exist.
Well, no, it is measured, though. We can observe the effects of it.
Yeah, the effects of it. Well, we can observe the things that gravity is supposedly causing. For example, things sticking to the earth, things falling when you let go of them. But I don't see why that can't all be explained with density.
You've lost me there. I'm not sure what you mean, because,
matter is denser than the air, and so it doesn't float off into it because it's denser. It's
So gravity has more of an effect on dense heavy stuff than it does on lighter stuff.
I don't know. Yeah, I understand. I understand the theory, and it is the theory of gravity. Let's appreciate as is theory of evolution and all the rest of them, and it could be valid. But I don't have a need for it personally. I know that things that are denser than their environment are going to drop, are going to fall, are going to sink, and things that are lighter than their environment are going to rise to the surface. You call it gravity, you can call it Allah, you can call it Vishnu. I don't really mind what you call it.
I don't really understand what the counter argument is. What do flat earthers? I don't understand. Why do they? I'm not sure what the argument is.
Well, it depends who you ask. I suppose everyone had different ideas. But I suppose one of the arguments might be that the reason gravity was thrown about and talked about and, let's say, invented to begin with, it was to add, to band-aid and to bandage on top of the foundational lie that we're on a spinning ball to begin with. Because you need something to explain how water sticks to a ball, when it's upside down. And how people can walk upside down in Australia. You need something, you need almost a magical, mystical force to explain that, and, hence gravity. density alone won't do, because everyone in Australia would just fall off.
That's not really making sense to me, I'm afraid.
Fair enough. And I'm not, you know, I'm not decided either way, and I don't need to be. One thing I'd recommend, though, if you are going to look into it, is if you're going to YouTube it, 6 months ago there was like there's loads of great stuff in the first few results. Now you have to scroll down for Christmas.
Right.
Eric Dubai is a good one. Eric Dubay is how you spell it. It might be Dubay. He's got some great stuff. There's a channel called Beyond the Imaginary Curve with a Scottish chap called Dell.
I'll check
it. He's got some good stuff. I think he was the one that was first sort of making the point of, you know, when you fill a bath, the water takes the shape of the inside of the bath.
So what?
And the same in a pond, the same in a lake, the same in an ocean. And say you bent the corners of the bath over, the water wouldn't stick to that outside of the bath and curve around. It just pour out, because water always, always finds its level.
At
no size other than Earth size do we see an example of water conforming to the exterior of a shape and not finding its level. The only supposed place in the universe we can say that happens is Earth. And are the photographs of it that aren't CGI?
I'm really trying to understand, but that you lose me. The explanation loses me. I don't follow what the point being made is. I don't understand the argument.
For example, in the southern hemisphere, you know, all that water, all those oceans that are in the southern hemisphere.
Yeah.
It's like, why? What? How the hell does that? Why is that there? Why is that not falling off?
What's wrong with the conventional explanation where gravity goes towards the centre of the Earth? I mean, that explains it.
Because there's no, because water always finds its level. Water is about as natural, as therefore predictable substance I think you can possibly get. That's one thing it always does. Be it lakes, baths, ponds. Only on this Earth that we've never seen with our own eyes does it magically bend round curves.
Oh.
And I'm not sure if that's true. And I ask for proof, I ask for evidence, and they just say gravity. And I'm like, what is it? Oh, it's the thing that does that thing to the water. Right?
Okay. Nah, I reckon you're wasting your time with this, Dean. Seriously, I mean, I'm open-minded to it. Like, you know, I'm happy to hear an explanation. I'm happy to hear it if it makes sense. But to me, that sounds like a sort of mishmash of several different concepts. I think you're wasting your time on that, honestly.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Well, I'm the same with the round thing, you know. I'm happy to hear explanations of it, not people telling me, it's been discovered. But, you know, if someone can break down exactly how it all works, I'm happy to listen. And I've heard both sides.
Water only appears to go flat, but in reality, it's stuck all the way around the edge of the Earth, because it's being sucked towards the centre of the Earth all the way around. So, like on our little micro scale, it appears to be flat in the glass or in the bath or something, but it's actually curving around the Earth. Obviously, that's the conventional explanation, but I don't see the error in that explanation. I don't see why that is. What's the flaw in that?
I don't know. Strong enough to hold a body of water as big as an ocean to its surface, yet weak enough that a fly can take off, or I can skip down the street.
Yeah, because
how about if the Earth's turning, right? How is it 1,000 miles an hour or something like that the Earth's spinning?
Is something like that. Yeah, it's a lot, isn't it?
A lot. It's fast. Like, how high would I have to jump, and then to the point where I land, it would be in a different place, off a different town. If it's 1,000 miles an hour, I suppose if I could possibly jump high enough, that I'd be in the air for 20 seconds, 30 seconds. I'd at least be a part way down the street, wouldn't I, by the time I landed?
No, because the air is moving.
No, that wouldn't happen.
The air is moving with the Earth, though.
So the air would move me along with it.
Yeah.
So the air is pulled by gravity.
Well, if the air was stationary and the Earth was spinning sort of under it and you jumped up, the air would sweep you backwards, wouldn't it? But it's not. The air is sort of in a, It's rotating at the same speed as the Earth.
I don't know. Like, is it hummingbirds that the ones that can fly in the same place?
Yeah.
Hover, you know. So if they hover in the same place for an hour, by the time they're done hovering, they should be 1,000 miles in whichever opposite direction of which way the Earth's spinning.
No, because the air is moving at the same speed as the surface of the Earth.
Okay, I see what you're saying, but I don't know. I don't know if I agree. I don't ever see that.
Like, it's like, if you stir a cup of tea and you stir it and stir it and stir it and stir it, it's like all the fluid is sort of joins the speed of the teaspoon that you're spinning, doesn't it? And the air just is entrained at the same speeds that the surface of the Earth is spinning. So relatively speaking, there is no speed as we experience it on the surface.
Right. Yeah, I'm not denying that. I have a hard, and this doesn't mean it's wrong. It doesn't necessarily mean I'm a retard. Mm. But I have a hard time wrapping my head around a ball with holes on it that's covered in water, which holds all that water in, spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, which is, that is spinning around the sun, which I think even faster speed. And with sun, the whole solar system is spinning around a galaxy at another ridiculous speed. And all that is flying off somewhere, God knows where, in an even faster speed. And the water's still there. None of the water flies off. If I dance with a beer in my hand, by the time the song's over, half it's not there anymore.
Yeah, but
you can get solar systems spinning and spinning that way, and it's on its axis. It's all tilted, don't forget. And there's a bit of me that wonders, Ben, and it's just a wonder that, you know, like I was talking about before with Neil deGrasse Tyson, so much of this scientism seems to be you're so insignificant. One insignificant, inconsequential grain of sand on a beach of infinite. I get the impression, I wonder if it's all just trying to make us feel small. Like you'll never know. You pray to the gods of science because you'll never know what's, you know, it's all this incomprehensible, impossible stuff. And I wonder if some of it's a bit deliberate.
Well,
I wonder.
He is a little bit pompous and obnoxious, but I don't think that has anything to do with the Earth being flat, you know.
No, sir. You know, you're an actor, right? I'm not.
No.
Making it up. He's been in TV shows and films and stuff. And I think before he was. Same with Bill Nye. I think before he was Bill Nye, the science guy, he was on, you know, Disney stuff and Comedy Central stuff and what have you.
The centripetal, you know, you're saying the Earth is spinning. So the reason the water doesn't flow, like if you spin something really fast and the water flies off it like a bike wheel or something.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's centripetal or centrifugal. There's a name because the outward force.
Centrifugal force.
Yeah, whatever it is, it's one of those. Oh. It's like an outward force. Mm-hmm. But because the effect of gravity on the water is a greater force than that outward force, because like even the Earth is massive, it's not spinning, it's spinning slowly, isn't it? So it's only like it's like a bike, it's like a bicycle wheel sort of being spun, you know, round one time every 24 hours, isn't it? It's going very, very slow. So the actual outward force does not exceed the gravitational inward force, and so the water doesn't fly off. Now, if you're dancing around with a beer,
I don't know about that. Go on.
Well, yeah, because the Earth isn't spinning fast. I mean, it's huge and it's going 1,000 miles an hour, but in terms of actual a rotation, it's not spinning fast. So,
1,000 miles an hour is fat. Like if you're 8 foot tall, and you're running 1,000 miles an hour, or if you're an inch tall and you're running 1,000 miles an hour, you're both going to hit the finish line at the same time. And by the way, you're running very fast.
No, but it's relative to the
retain.
It's relative to the size of the circle, isn't it? The actual outwards force. Literally, imagine it. Imagine a bicycle wheel, and you're turning it so slowly that it only turns once every 24 hours.
Right.
There's just hardly any outward force on that. Any raindrops that are on it are not going to be. But then if you whiz it, then they'll fly off, you know. So the
If you
Earth is
whiz
going.
it, they'll fly off, and if you turn it very slowly, they will do what water does. They'll try and find the level. They'll all drip to the bottom, and there'll be a little puddle underneath the wheel where they've all dripped to the bottom and fallen off because the water is denser than the air. It's heavier than the air, denser than the air, and so it'll fall to the bottom and find it. There'll be a pool of water on the ground, and it'll be turning the wheel in the street looking like a dummy trying to prove the round Earth.
I reckon there's many things that you're right about, and I think this isn't one of them.
Hey, no, you. I mean, yeah, you could be right. You very could be right. And this is a new thing for me. You know, I've not been on this long at all. And I'm not saying I'm on it. You know, I'm a skeptic. I'm wondering about it. And in a few weeks, I may have, you know, completely turned on it. But what fascinated me, I think most of all, was that, like, I thought it was a done deal. I thought it was just like a settled case. I didn't think there were any. I couldn't believe there was a debate going on. And the more I tried to look for, you know, some serious evidence that wasn't just trying to make me feel small and insignificant, as opposed to people giving evidence to the contrary, the more I was like, "What the fuck's going on here?" And maybe it's all just maybe it is my inability to comprehend. Maybe it's a mixture of all these things. I'm not sure, but you know how it is, Ben. You know, we're being lied to about a lot of stuff. And I wonder what depths it runs to. What it
Yeah,
is, man.
that's fair enough. I mean, you know, I
I know
spent.
that, you know, it's one thing to know that the tabloids lie and the news lie, but then it's like there's lies and then there's evil, and then there's like I don't know where I'm going with this.
Yeah, you know, I mean, obviously, it's good to be open-minded, and I've spent my fair share of time watching fucking conspiracy theories about aliens and ghosts and Bigfoot and shit like that. But you know that. There is a point, like it has to be credible, and I don't, there's nothing I've ever heard on any of those flat earth videos that I've seen that make any sense to me. Is, you know, I mean, I don't mind theories about 9/11, and you know, there's certain people who benefit from that, and I don't mind theories about like ancient artifacts and weird shit that, you know, that could point to potential alien visitors. But when I listen to that information and the explanations about flat Earth, it does not resonate with me with any credibility. Nothing in it makes any sense to me.
All right. I believe I could send you a couple that will,
All right.
that you won't see. I honestly do.
I'll take the challenge. Go on then.
Yeah, I'm not saying, you know, I have to keep reiterating this because we live in a mad world, flat or not. You know, I'm not saying I believe it. I'm not saying it's proof or anything like that. It was just the very fact that a few did resonate with me, and I was like, hang on, this is wow, there's something here. That was enough to alarm me. Now, I'm not even in the realm of thinking about proof and stuff. Just the fact that there are real questions that aren't answered is was enough to just.
What was is could has anything jumped to mind that you can remember?
Loads, man. Oh, unfortunately, I can't pull anything off the top of my head. A lot of it does relate to the moon thing and the moon landing, a lot of that I was looking at.
And also, here's one that I was thinking about. So, say the Earth is flat, like a plate, and like Australia's on one side, and what's the other side? I'm trying to remember how the map looks, but
It's
so.
the UN's logo, interestingly. If you look at the UN's logo, it's the model of flat Earth that flat Earthers use. It's the same thing, exactly.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't find
And
that.
here's one. Sorry, because it is one that's come to me. It's an unanswered. It's not. Oh, well, it is a mystery, at least as far as I'm concerned. But it's not a conspiracy theory. Is the Antarctic Treaty? The largest governmental economic powers on the globe, Japan, Russia, China, America, Britain, you know, normally don't see eye to eye on all sorts of things, have agreed that no independent explorers can visit the Antarctica. It's illegal. You get arrested or shot. It's manned all the time, militarily. And unless you go with a tour, you know, a guided tour, which is very controlled, a bit like North Korea, you'll be arrested. Or straight up shot. It's completely illegal to go to Antarctica as an independent explorer. I don't know why that is. I know the official explanation, and I know the flat Earth explanation.
I mean, I definitely find that interesting, and it wouldn't surprise me if there's some shit going on there, you know, that they don't want us to know about. I could find that believable. Maybe there's, who knows, there could be anything.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. It could be weapons testing, military stuff, you know, that's, I don't know, maybe anything. Who knows? But the flat Earth explanation is that the North Pole is that center of that flat Earth model, and the South Pole is the exterior of the full circle, right? The ice wall, if you've ever heard that one. And they don't want us to go there because it's the edge. And that's about as fruity as it gets, I know. And the official explanation is that all these warmongering superpowers have got together and decided Antarctica is to be used for peaceful purposes only. That's the official statement. This is to be used for peaceful purposes only. Yet, if you go there as an independent explorer, you'll be shot or arrested for trying to explore it. So it's not very peaceful, is it? So I don't know what's going on with it, but there's something going on with it. Something is going on with it, for sure.
If you said there's a secret alien military base there, like, that would make more sense to me. As incredible as that would be, that would be slightly more likely than it meaning that the Earth is flat.
Right. I don't know. Maybe that's what they want you to think, then. Maybe they're preparing you for the invasion. Who knows?
I think you've got to weigh things up, you know, like, you get, if something's really not a strong and convincing or compelling argument, you kind of, you have to weigh stuff up, you know, you can't give it all equal value, you know, like the UN logo appears to be, you know, the flat Earth symbol. Well, I don't find that to be strong evidence of anything. All it means is a logo, you know. If there's something strong, I want to hear it. But yeah. I think you got to be a bit self-critical.
I mean, sort of what you're looking for, the UN logo to be the letters that spell out TF dick faces. The world is flat. You know, they're not going to do that, are they? That's not how symbolism works. If they're going to hide this stuff and mock us with this stuff, it's going to be in pictures and symbols and things like that. And what I'd ask is, why is that the logo? Why is it not the globe?
It's just not proof of anything.
I'm not saying it's that because the Earth's flat. I'm saying, why are they doing it?
Well,
and it's a bit of a not connected exercise as well, you know.
How do you explain flight times? Like, because if the Earth is flat as opposed to a globe, then all the flight times of how long it takes to get everywhere are sort of out of whack. So what's the flat Earth explanation for that?
I don't know. I've seen pilots interviewed being asked, you know, do you have to take the curvature of the Earth into account and dip the nose at certain points? And they just look completely bemused. And people saying, you know, if you're flying against the rotation of the Earth, you know, the way it's spinning, can you get there in like 10 minutes as opposed to if you're going the other way? Well, they'd take hours, and they're just like, I'm not a pilot, and I'm not pretending to know what's up with that stuff, but
That's back to the thing. It's because the airspeed is going.
You don't take into account the curvature nor the rotation of the Earth when they fly as if it were a flat plane.
Yeah, but the curve is extremely gradual, though, and the plane is constantly adjusting. You know, every microsecond is constantly twitching and adjusting, and you know the flaps are responding to the turbulence all the time. So it's constantly adjusting to its height and its direction and everything. So it's making micro adjustments. The pilots wouldn't even if they were doing it manually, they wouldn't notice, like, dipping the nose. It's too gradual for that.
You probably wouldn't notice it as in, like, right, this is a bit where we dip, but if they were manually controlling it, they would have to know at what point to start dipping and at what point
even
if it's over an hour and very gradual.
It's not noticeable. It's a huge curve with hardly any noticeable, no noticeable change. It appears to be flat, ironically. You know, that's how huge it is. And so a pilot would never notice having to dip the nose because the globe's too big.
That one does sound a bit silly.
And the thing about, you know, whether you're going with the spin or against the spin, again, that's the same thing, because the airspeed is moving in unity with the speed of the surface of the Earth. So as far as moving around on the globe, we appear to be stationary. There's no noticeable effects of the spinning of the Earth because the airspeed is relatively...
I don't know about the airspeed thing, Ben. Especially not if you're in a plane going at... Right, what do you say the Earth's going? 1,000 miles an hour, I think we estimated. So you're going 700 miles an hour. So 700 plus the 1,000 in one direction, which is going to be 1,000 minus 700 in the other direction. It's going to take substantially longer to get there. And they'd have to account for that with fuel, with, you know, how long it takes. And the pilots have seen quizzes on it.
They what?
Sort of the pilots that I've seen asked this and quizzed about, you know, do you take into account the speed and rotation of the Earth when you find, say, east versus west? And they all seem to have that same look of...
Yeah, but it's because
I've never said what.
It's because it's a silly question, though.
Right. Or maybe it's because they straight away they know what they're getting at, thinking, like, are you one of these flat earthers?
Yeah, it's got no bearing on reality. That's why they look perplexed.
Does it not? So asking, do you have to take into account the curvature of the rotation of the Earth when making flights,
because they don't, because it's a silly question.
One thing to say that they don't have to, but why is it a silly question?
Because the effects of what you're talking about, like the curvature, are so negligible. It's not a part of piloting a plane. So it's and with the airspeed thing, bear in mind the ragged surface of the Earth is sort of has friction, doesn't it? So it's dragging the air along with it in unity with it. And there's not, if you go up into space, there's no resistance going in the opposite direction to slow that air down or to reduce it. There's nothing to decelerate the air. There's only the traction of the surface of the Earth to drag it along. So it wouldn't slow down like a car slows down, sort of under resistance, because there's no resistance in the other direction. You see what I mean?
A little, I think.
Like, if you had...
I just think this... The speed it's allegedly spinning at is very fast, and every time you ask, you know, you try and get people to account for it or show evidence of it, it's like, oh, well, it's you'll never, it's too small, you won't see it. But then when they describe it in grand terms, it's, we're tilted on an axis, spinning at this fast, spinning around the sun even faster, so everything's fucking fucked up, spinning around fast, flying around, no particular aim, going in no particular direction. It's almost a metaphor for the projected meaninglessness of life that they'd like us to adopt. And every time it's asked to be accounted for, it's like, oh, well, it's insignificant. And I'm not saying you, I'm saying the scientismists that I look to for these answers. I'm yet to be satisfied, other than consensus. And you know how I feel about consensus. Terrifies me.
I reckon you're not this one on the head, not the episode, I mean that topic. I reckon you're wasting your time with that, honestly.
Yeah, I kind of hope you're right, man, in a lot of ways, you know.
Yeah,
and for the first whatever it was, I think a few days, when a little penny dropped of, okay, I'm at least curious here, I denied it to myself for a while. I was like, no, I'm not. I'm not bringing this up. I'm not asking any friends. I'm not curious. This is just funny. And here I am, talking to you about it for real on a podcast.
Yeah. I don't think...
Yeah, we'll see, man. Maybe in a few weeks I'll go, oh, do you know what? Yeah. The adrenaline got the better of me, and there's not enough evidence. But I need more evidence to the contrary, and that's what will quell my suspicion. You know, and it's always, all I get is screeching leftists. Not all I get, but a way of putting it. It reminds me, it's like, you can't actually, and I'm like, I've been here before, politically.
Yeah. It's got echoes of all the things that we do know about, you know, that people deny and resist and stuff, and then when people behave in the same way to this topic, it sort of makes you wonder, well, maybe it is fucking true. But,
right, yeah. I guess my alarm bell's going.
But on this particular instance, it's a dead end, that one.
Well, I respect your opinion. You respect my curiosity.
Yeah.
That's what matters.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, this is...
I don't want to spend forever on this. You know, I'm not trying to... I'm certainly not trying to sell the flat earth to anyone.
When you think about it, this is the way things should be discussed, isn't it? You know, like, because we've got a difference of opinion on this. And and we're discussing it as things should be discussed, you know, sensibly, aren't we?
Pretty much, yeah, as far as I can see, yeah.
And I think that says a lot about us.
I think, yeah. The fact that we haven't descended into calling each other bigots.
You're a racist.
Well, you would say that, Ben, as a... ableist homophobe.
Isn't it weird when people lose the argument, they suddenly decide the other person's a racist?
Yeah, man. It's fucking huge. I got some woman today on the, you know, and I was saying like, whoa, Michelle Obama's got a dick. And that was one of the ones I got off this woman. It was, by the way, before this woman, this white woman chirped up, I'd had several back and forths with black women who were like, this is interesting, blah, blah, blah. And all of a sudden, this white woman just burst in and went, you racist piece of shit!
Yeah.
But like, I'm not racist. You know, I'm not always a piece of shit. I wondered how long before someone pulled that one on me. And why is it always the white girls?
Yeah.
In the day.
I think it comes from cowardice. You know, I'm sure we probably said this on our previous conversations. It's like they're so eager to let everybody know that they're on the good team, and the way they do that is to point the finger at someone else just to let everyone know they're a good person. And it's cowardice. They're afraid of... They don't want to be labelled. They don't want to be ostracised. They don't want any blowback or any negative repercussions of any point of view. And so they just adopt the point of view, the safe. I think that's what it is.
Yeah, absolutely, it is, man. I've seen it. I know it like the back of my hand. Part of me wants to take those women in and nurture them and say, look, it's all right. Express yourself. Think what you want. Let's talk it out. Part of me wants to drop kick them off each and head. I'm sick of them. That's exactly it. Yeah. The group or gang or whatever that's most objectively dangerous in their mind, in their opinion, is the one I'll side with.
One. Say again?
The one that's the most objectively dangerous in their mind is typically the one they'll side with. I think that's a lot of the all this pro-Islam stuff, you know, all these, it's always weak, nerdy, stupid men and histrionic, frantic women who are like, oh God, Islam's so amazing, I love Islam, I just Islam, and I think it's partly because they can see, Islam don't take any shit. It's not, whereas atheist and agnostic white Western males still take all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
You know, I can sit here and debate and be called names and back and forth all day. You know, they can see themselves a bit on this side, but when you get into hardcore Islamism, that's not something they can, in any capacity, consider themselves even going up against. So it's just like...
Yeah, they...
Reactionary, oh, I love Islam!
It's like...
Allahu Akbar!
It's like in a school playground, like siding with the bully just to keep yourself safe, really. I mean, how spineless can you get?
Yeah, it is. It is. And I often get confused, you know, how many of them see their own spinelessness with this culty kind of stuff. and how many are like legit just like emotionally reacting to it and think it's think they've got the moral high ground because CNN said so, and don't actually see that this been whipped into the frenzy of agreeing with the school bully because safety.
Mm.
I wonder. My mate was talking about earlier was saying, like, no, man, they don't see it. They think Trump's evil. They think left is heaven, and they think you're wrong and a bigot. And I'm like, I don't know if they do, man. I think they know that's what they're meant to say. I'm talking about, obviously, a percentage. I think people know that's what they're expected to say and have to be. But I think everyone has that moment when it's either one drink too many or you can't sleep that particular night and you're tossing and turning, or you catch your eye when you're brushing your teeth and they go, oh, am I being...
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm being honest with myself here. I think there's a percentage of them out there, man, because there's some, you know... I've been one in parts with in my later days of anarchy and stuff and voluntarism, sort of clinging to it because it's what I know.
Mm.
You know, even if it's not necessarily the most practical and realistic.
Yeah, a slight change of topic, but it reminded me of something.
Hit me.
It's more of a psychology thing. There's this, he's kind of a motivational speaker called John DeMartini. He's a sort of, he's kind of a Tony Robbins similar kind of thing. Have you heard of him?
No, I know Tony Robbins.
Okay, right, yeah, sure. Similar kind of guy. He's written loads of books, does loads of seminars, that kind of thing. So years ago, I went on a few of his seminars, I read a few of his books, and it came up in our coaching group recently because Alex is into it as well. So we were talking about John DeMartini. One of the exercises he does, like if you're infatuated with somebody, he gets you to sort of write down all their positive traits, write down all their negative traits, and balance it all out in your mind. Like, write down the drawbacks to all the positive things that you see in them. Write down all the advantages of all the negative things you see in them. And it goes really in depth. Like, he makes you do it in columns, or like a spreadsheet, or like a table kind of thing. And he makes you write down who are all the people that see the exact opposite trait in that person. So when you see them as terrible or wonderful or whatever it is, write a list of the people who see the exact opposite at the same time. You know, and when that person was doing that trait to you, who else were they doing the opposite to? And basically, the exercise makes you balance out all your perceptions of how you believe they are, kind of thing, until you just sort of feel more neutral and more sort of more indifferent, that there's like a until you get the sense that there's kind of a greater balance, you know, at play. And it works on a sort of positive end. So if there's someone you're resentful to, you know, the exercise works the same. If there's someone you're infatuated with, it works the same. And it's really good.
That's really cool. I was going to say, I've done that with myself in the past when I've not. This is why I want to check this guy out, because it seems, and I'm sure he's going to like more in depth. And like, he's got columns and stuff, and there's like a whole system to it.
Hmm.
It sounds ace. But the basic, it's the thing I used to do. Used to do. I've done a few times. When I've been in situations where it's been with a girl, like I said, that I'm infatuated with, even though she's like pure evil, and everyone around me saying it, and my heart saying it, but for some reason I can't get unhooked off her. I would write myself a list of pros and cons, and then try and just look at that list, you know, as objectively as I can, and it'd be like, yeah, man.
Yeah.
To see it written down in black and white, you know, not processed through my emotions.
Yeah,
it's like, and how easy it is to list, like, say, the flaws and the pros.
Yeah, that's a good exercise to do.
It's great. What's this guy's name?
John DeMartini. I can send you the stuff. I got some of his audio and stuff.
Man. Yeah, I do. So, like, that was just I'm not sure if my mum suggested it, actually, if that was just on my own whim. But that's a good thing to do. If there's more to it.
Yeah, because like, as right as we are about the stuff we believe, you know, even us, we're still fallible to like being emotionally charged about how we believe the world is and how we believe, you know, because like, maybe maybe the stuff we see with leftists being outrageous, you know, maybe we're just seeing the few instances where they behave terribly, you know, but like 99% of the time, you know, they're kind of relatively normal and relatively reasonable. So like, you know, it's good to be, it's good to doubt yourself, isn't it? And
Yeah, definitely.
Especially if it's kind of negative stuff, because me and you, you know, it winds us up, and we both get stressed about all this stuff at times. And it's it's good to sort of question your own perceptions, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And find a balance in it, some sort of harmony. It's like you say about the leftists, you know, the stuff that gets all the views, the stuff that gets uploaded and downloaded and re-uploaded, it's when they flip out, you know. And for every time a leftist flips out, you know, there's probably 10 of them buying a coffee.
Yeah. And, it, and you know, it does happen. It's not that it doesn't happen, but, you know.
Oh, right. Yeah, it happens.
It happens, but
it does. It certainly happens more frequently than, say, on the right. But
like, you can get the impression that the whole world is behaving that way, can't you? When in reality, it might be three people, you know, in that moment, you know.
Yeah. And three people who'll behave like that once every 6 months, maybe for a 20-minute period.
Yeah,
I don't know.
So
that's definitely a thing. When I spend a lot of time looking at uploads and videos and latest news and this destroys and that fucking calmly dismantled. You got to bear in mind, you know, all the stuff that's being uploaded is the most extreme. This just in. Can you believe what happened? Look at what this fucking idiot said. It's all that stuff. So it's, you know, it's going to be extreme examples of human condition, you know.
Yeah,
most of it's not that hostile and not that demanding. I don't think I get that sometimes, you know. I've isolated myself a bit and I'm looking at these like greatest hits of humanity's output, you know, craziest moments. Sometimes, like walking through town, it's like I'm ready for a bit of a joust. Like, everyone's just getting on with the day.
yeah What's going on with that thing you were going
to? We're all pretty peaceful, which is a good thing. You know that old Bill Hicks joke? And he's like, you watch the news and see, it's like, war, poverty, death, cancer, AIDS. And you look out your window, it's just, birds cheeping.
Yeah.
What are you saying?
Oh, I was getting, what's going on with that group you were going to?
What's that?
I can't remember, it's some support group. I can't remember what it's called.
Oh, yeah. I stopped going. Yeah, I stopped going.
What's wrong with it?
It was just... There was nothing I couldn't Google. It just wasn't particularly helpful. I thought they'd have, like, I don't know, helpful information, tips, strategies, philosophy, something. It was mainly a guy who looked pretty bored, giving me leaflets. And giving me sort of this hallmark advice, you know, do the best you can.
Yeah, just not very inspiring environment then.
No, it just, no, you know, so whatever. Probably, I'm sure it works for some people and that, I'm not dissing them, but I just wasn't getting anything out of it.
Yeah.
If anything, I felt like I was just lingering a little bit more in perceived problems than I was enjoying my life, if you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Not, you know, not that there aren't still, you know, there's still, I'm far from perfect, man. I've got flaws to be ironed out, but I don't think that wasn't the path.
Yeah, fair enough. I wonder what is. Church? Hiking? I don't know.
Maybe church. Thinking about that, you know.
Join a running club.
Hey?
I said join a running club. They're sociable.
No. Whatever we're going to talk about along the way, can we not do this over a beer? Can we not sit down and hash it out?
Yeah.
We have to run.
Yeah, I've been tempted to go to church a few times. I never got round to it. It's like, it's not high enough on my priorities, you know.
Same. It's not, I never feel like the urge. It's just like, it's in the back of my mind a bit more all the time. I'm like, what goes on in there? Let's have a look at it. I hear things from people that go, and some aren't even that religious, and just say it's a really nice community thing, and it's just a nice moment to be in awe of the fact we don't necessarily understand how the universe works and who or if made it or whatever. And, you know, it's a bit humbling and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
I like singing songs. I can do some harmonies.
Yeah, there's worse places like to be, isn't there? And they're probably relatively conservative, aren't they?
Yeah, probably, right? I bet you don't get too many screeching liberals at church.
Probably not, no. I mean, Christian values are traditional and conservative, aren't they, I presume?
Yeah, pretty much. That's the thing Marroni spoke about in the past, which I'm sure you've noticed, is... And I think it's one of the reasons I floundered a little bit for so long, is... The god of left-wing is government. Obviously, I'm speaking in generalities.
Mm.
The god of left-wing is whoever it is, Jeremy Corbyn, whoever's going to be Bernie Sanders, communism, socialism, the big authoritarian mother figure who's coincidentally always an old white man who's going to take care of everybody. And the right-wing god is God, a.k.a. no government.
Yeah.
Or at least a minimal one, you know?
Yeah. I don't
definite theme there, isn't there?
I don't fully understand the ins and outs of it, but I have heard Jordan Peterson and Stefan Molyneux talk about like the problem with atheism is it leaves a moral void, you know, like at least religious people get, you know, a moral framework from their religion that on the most part works, you know, if you stick to it, is pretty much okay, you know, it gives you something to live by. But atheists, it doesn't replace it with anything other than statism. And they got no set of rules to live by.
That's right. And it's not always just, it's not like a moral framework always per se of how like to behave yourself, but it's often like, you know how you don't know everything? But yet there is an answer to everything.
Right. What do you mean?
Well, I think that's the truth. I think that's a fact that you don't know. I'll speak for myself, right? I don't know everything.
Mm.
Yet every question I believe can be answered.
Mm.
And so that yearning is almost in some way going to lead me to some kind of authority. And I don't know.
Yeah.
Once you've rejected that which you can't know on a personal level, you're going to look to humans, you know, and you're going to end up forming tyrannical governments in the hopes that they're looking out for your best interests, which of course they never are.
Mm. Well, yeah, this is why I admire Stefan Molyneux, because this is what he says, isn't it? You know, philosophy, it's the job of philosophy to give the correct answers. Unfortunately, people don't look to philosophers, they look to the state, you know, because the state gives out free goodies and religion isn't perfect either, but
yeah. I love Steph.
Yeah, I do. He's underrated.
Oh, yeah, he's amazing. He's amazing. And he's stayed true to his... And all of his views have changed and stuff and shifted. His principles have remained over the years, and his pursuit is just as hungry and it's just as legit.
For some reason, like even people like us in our sphere who are got a similar point of view on life as us are often reluctant to praise him. There's a lot of criticism of him, even.
Yeah, is
it? Yeah, like I notice 9 out of 10 people are reluctant to say they like him. They sort of hesitate. They kind of like, yeah, he's okay, you know, but I'm not sure. I don't know what it is. I find that really weird because I think he's great. But then I find it really easy to admire people. You know, I don't have any hesitancy about.
Yeah, I think. Well, you know, like me, you like independent people, don't you? You like independent thinkers and independent characters and stuff. And I think if people do, that it's not something they profess publicly, because Steph is clearly, if left wing is your cult, then Steph's clearly not your guy. And if right wing is your thing, then there's a lot of good reasons to say why Steph isn't your guy, because you've only got to scratch a year or two beneath the surface to find a raging anarchist, do you know what I mean?
Mm.
Completely anti-government voluntarist. And so... He's a philosopher, as he says. You know, he's his own guy. And I love that. I like the journey. And a lot of people want pure confirmation bias at all times. And so it's hard to, you know. He said something that will piss off 99.9% of people.
It's really weird. Like, have you ever noticed that thing? I've talked about it on Facebook. Like, when there's this weird thing that happens when someone's the best. Like, they go into this dead zone where no one will praise them. I don't know why that is.
Well, how do you mean? I think I can see this a bit in music, maybe.
It's like when
someone becomes too mainstream, man.
When someone's so good, like when they're so far and beyond number two, when they're number one by far, it's like people become reluctant to praise them anymore. And I don't know why it is, but I've noticed this, like, yeah, I see it everywhere.
I'm not sure if I have. I mean, can you think of an example?
Well, Facebook. I think Facebook is incredible. It's incredible. You know, it facilitates. And I know, you know, the controversy and stuff, but basically what it facilitates and what it does is incredible. And yet people will only sort of slag it off and bitch and moan and complain and, you know, criticize about it.
Yeah. 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 And, oh, yeah, all of them. Like any of the big, efficient, like, supermarkets with the most stock and the lowest prices, you know, your Astas, your Tesco's, a big evil corporation, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But if your mate opens up a shop next door selling socks and bars of soap, you know, it's amazing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly that. And same with bands as well. Like Stadium Band, best band ever, highest selling band ever, doing stadium tours. Well, yeah. I mean, clearly people like it because people attend the concert, but there's this, I don't know, maybe it's just certain kinds of people criticize greatness. It's like some kinds of people are uncomfortable with greatness.
I think I just had a little thought about what it might be. It's part of that doctrine of equality that we're supposed to believe in and strive for. If you can clearly identify that one band or one company or one whatever is like doing head and shoulders above the rest, that CNN instinct kicks in and it's like, oh, we have to bring them down a bit in order to, you know, elevate the rest.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's striving for equality in the bullshit sense of trying to make everything the same.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, I think you're right. And like Tony Robbins is another example.
For winners, there have to be losers, don't there?
Yeah, that's right. If you believe that paradigm, yeah.
I'm not necessarily losers, but, you know, first place, there has to be a second place.
Yeah, that's right. So if you believe in equality and everybody should be equal, then that's a violation of your beliefs, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Tony Robbins, another one. He's incredible. He's incredible. He's the best by far.
He is. Yeah, I love him. Yeah.
By far, by far, by far. His events are the best by far. And yet, you know, people are like, I don't know, he's a bit American.
Yeah. I've actually heard people say that. That's funny.
People's sphincters tighten when faced with someone truly great.
Hey, Tony Robbins is one of those people that, I don't know, there's a lot of people you can watch and, you know, you can be entertained from a distance and sort of take it or leave it. Like, Tony Robbins probably grabs you by the scruff of your balls. And it's like, are you going to make your life great? Because it's up to you. You know, it makes you feel, you know, your life is your responsibility. And it's like, I struggle to watch one of his things in full without coming away from it super motivated to do something. And I don't know. People don't like that pressure if it's not self-imposed, I don't think.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like with Jordan Peterson. We're like talking about, I think in the core of his message is enough with fucking rights. The meaning of life isn't to be found in rights and privileges. It's to be found in adopting responsibility, taking on the challenges of life. It's so true. It's so soul-shakingly true. You can't call him a racist for saying that. You don't get to call him a bigot for saying that. You have to go either come up with a better argument or stand up straight with your shoulders back.
He's fantastic. You know?
It's pressure, and Peterson.
Yeah, he's fantastic. I love his stuff.
He's good, isn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. No, he's fantastic. He's fantastic. I did a little thing in him last night, picking holes in him. I did a little thing in him last night, picking a few holes in him. Not necessarily picking holes in him, but humanizing him again. It's one of the things I'm wary of in myself is this idol worship, what I've done with Prince, what people do, Most dangerously of all with politicians, because that is obviously lethal. But I think it's important to remember everybody's human and has flaws and drawbacks. And did you see that guy running on stage saying, like, I'm unwell, I just want to meet Peterson, and like, he got tackled by security and stuff?
Yeah, I saw that, yeah.
It's like, and I did a video on him called Jordan Peterson Heals the Cripples.
I didn't see that.
Yeah, it's like, it's, you know what I mean? Something a bit, it gave me a weird feeling. It's like treating him like a religious figure type thing. And as great as he is, as good as his book is, the whole message of the book is just stand up straight with your shoulders back, not stand on Jordan Peterson's shoulders.
Yeah.
And the this is the Jewish question. That got me a bit.
I don't know anything about that. What's that?
Well, my whole thing with Peterson.
No, it's me. No, don't worry. I keep running out of credit. I got paid to call your bloody mobile number.
Yeah, bloody hell. Sorry, man.
No, it's all right. Don't worry. No, it's fine. Yeah.
You're all right.
Yeah, in future, maybe we'll find a way to do it on Skype, because then it's free then.
Yeah, man. Yeah, we'll do it on Skype or something next time, eh?
Yeah, it's all right. Don't worry about it.
I'll figure it out.
Yeah. Yeah, you were just saying about Peterson.
Yeah, the thing that really got me with him, that I sort of fell in love with him to begin with, was, you know, the classic thing. All the letters are saying, here's the new lexicon, these are the words you have to use. And little old scrawny dungaree wearing Peterson said, no, I won't do it. And the world uproared. And he was like, Canada was passing that C-16 bill, you know, threat of imprisonment. And he was even talking about going on a hunger strike. And I was just like, this guy's the bomb. You know, he's standing by his principles at the point of saying, I don't care if it's law or not, I won't be told what words I have to use. And I'm like, this man's fucking, if he's anything, he's brave. Turns out he's also a genius and all that. But when he was asked the Jewish question, it was horrible to see. He skulks off into the corner of the stage, like with his head in his hands, like a is my career about to be over moment. Ponders for about 10 seconds and then literally goes, I can't do it. And the crowd sort of gasps a bit and he eventually moves on.
Oh, I haven't seen that. So he just wouldn't answer that topic?
Yeah, he just wouldn't. He said, I can't do it. And I took that to mean I won't do it because I know he's smart. I know he's got he must have had a billion opinions bouncing around his brain when he was stood there thinking. He says, I can't do it. And I think what it means is, I won't do it because it's, I don't know what, trouble. I think to some degree he's enjoying his success. He's aware who runs the world and he doesn't want to poke the wrong bees' nests.
Yeah, I suppose there's many ways of interpreting that. I mean, in a way I admire his intuition. Clearly he could sense that, like, it wouldn't be the most advantageous route to go down to answer that question. So, you know, I don't know if that's good or bad, but clearly he's got a very attuned perception of, you know, the consequences and the future and
Hey, and you know what? Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, for sure he's a fuck ton wiser than I am, and it could have well been in his mind, if I start talking crap about Jews, my bigger messages of self-responsibility and, you know, growing yourself and developing yourself as an individual, that's all going to get lost, and I'm not going to be able to keep doing this and send the messages to the matters because I'll be labelled an anti-Semite and all that stuff. So maybe he avoided it to continue talking the shit that matters.
Did he ever come back and confront the topic on a different occasion?
Not that I've seen. Possibly, so I don't want to say no. I've had a look and I have not said no.
It'd be interesting to know what's going through his mind. Like, maybe just in that moment he just had brain fog and just didn't know how to answer it sort of constructively. Yeah, and
it was Solzhenitsyn, one of his sort of his big people that he talks about a lot, and one of his books he's always particularly talking about, Gulag Archipelago, is it?
Okay.
The guy was asking, well, what about Solzhenitsyn's other book? When he talked about the Holodomor, where the Jews starved millions of people in, I can't remember the country, forgive me. And he's like, you know, who's to say that wouldn't or couldn't happen again? I mean, that was part of the question. Peterson was almost acting like he'd never heard of the book.
Really?
Yeah, and I'm giving some leeway in that. He wasn't expecting the question. You know, he's on stage. He's not used to being on stage. I think he's pretty new to the whole touring the world thing.
Okay.
You know, doesn't want to get labelled with things that could potentially blur the greater message, so I'll cut some leeway. But
yeah, I'll look that up. I wasn't aware of that. Hey, Dean, I think I'm going to have to get off the phone. I said I'd go and speak to my housemates at 7, so...
All right, yeah, man.
Yeah.
All good.
All right.
Nothing to do anyway. Nice one, Ben.
Good talking. Speak soon.
Yes. Nice one.
Cheers.
See you later.
Bye.